Hello, my name is Sharif, and I'm going to take you through a quick tutorial of how to get started with creating mobile workspaces in the Microsoft Dynamics 365 for Operations mobile app. On the left-hand side of the screen in front of you, I'm running Dynamics 365 for Operations in Microsoft Edge, and on the right-hand side of the screen, I am projecting an Android device onto my computer screen. It's a physical Android device that I have in front of me, and as I interact with the device, you'll be able to see my finger trails on the screen. I can also interact with the device using the mouse and keyboard since it's attached directly to the Android device. So the first thing we're going to do as we get started is sign into the app. The first step of signing into the app is to provide it with the address for my particular operation subscription. In that case, the address is up here in the address bar. I'll go ahead and paste that address into the mobile app using my mouse and keyboard on my computer. The next step is to specify the company ID. Company ID is also known as a legal entity, and in this case, I'm using USMF. So I'll go ahead and specify USMF in the mobile app. Now, entering the company ID or entering the legal entity into the mobile app is an optional step. It's not required. If you don't specify the company ID, then when you log in, you'll be placed into whatever your default legal entity or default company is based on your operations user preferences. So after specifying the address and optionally specifying my legal entity, I simply tap on connect. The next step is the as a user of the mobile app, I'll be provided with a disclaimer prompt. What this is informing me is that when I connect to this operations instance, metadata and executable code will be downloaded from this operations instance and into my mobile device. And this executable code can be executed within the process of the mobile app, of the Dynamics 365 for Operations mobile app. This is important because the mobile app may have been granted permissions for me, the mobile user. I may have given the mobile app permissions to access my files and access my camera. And in that case, the executable code that is downloaded from my operations instance will also have access to my files and access to my camera. And this executable code is not necessarily code provided by Microsoft. It is code provided by whoever runs that operations instance. So we're informing the user of that. They simply tap, I understand. And when they tap connect, they'll be taken to the Microsoft Azure Active Directory login screen. And here they'll simply provide the user credentials for whatever user account they use to log into operations. In this case, I'm using the administrator account. I don't need to use the administrator account to log into the mobile app, but for the sake of the demo, I am. So let me go ahead and enter the administrator credentials. And as I enter the password here, let me go ahead and minimize the screen to protect that information. There we go. So we'll tap sign in. All right, and the first thing we see is a prompt. This is the prompt asking if I want to give permissions to the app to access files on my device. And this is necessary for some other scenarios we'll see later on in tutorial videos where you can access the files on the device as part of capturing a document and uploading that document in a business process. All right, so what we see on the mobile device now is what we're calling the mobile dashboard. And what it shows is a list of mobile workspaces. Now, the list of mobile workspaces is not a one-to-one correlation with the list of workspaces we see here in the operations web client. Each one of these mobile workspaces was independently crafted for a particular mobile scenario with a very specific mobile optimized user experience. In this case, we have the sample reservation management app, which we'll touch on in a later video. We also have four of the mobile workspaces that we've already shipped at this point from Microsoft to our customers. Cost controlling, inventory on hand, sales orders, and vendor collaboration. We won't be touching on those workspaces in this tutorial video. In this video, we'll be focused on creating one from scratch, and we'll touch on some of the basic concepts involved in creating a mobile workspace. So we'll leave the Android device alone for a minute, and we'll hop back into the web client where we use operations. The first thing we're going to do is make sure that we have our UL parameter set up correctly. I need to be logged in as an administrator in order to create and publish mobile workspaces, and I am logged in as a system administrator user in operations. The second thing we want to do is access the mobile app menu, and this menu will be hidden unless you've added the URL parameter and mode equals mobile to your URL. So you can go ahead and add that, refresh the web tab, and after that you'll see the mobile app menu item there. You go ahead and select it. And now the mobile app designer shows up. So the pane that you see on the right-hand side that's pinned into the web client, we call this the app designer or the mobile workspace designer. What it allows you to do is control the publishing and the editing of your mobile workspaces. Right? So we'll move forward with this demo. We'll go ahead and create a new one. I'm running Microsoft Dynamics 365 for Operations on top of our Platform Update 4 version, which is why this designer may look a bit different if you're running Platform Update 3. All right, so the first thing I'll do is click on our Overflow button and say Create. All right, now I'm taken to the basic page where I provide some information for the mobile workspace. I can give it a name, description, color, and icon, and these are the things that are going to be displayed in this list. There we go. So I can choose a color next, and I can choose an icon. There we go. All right, so I've essentially designed the workspace. That's all that it takes to get an entry to appear inside of the mobile dashboard. I've designed the mobile workspace. The next step is to click Done. I provide it with some information for the mobile workspace, and this information may be useful later on, especially the ID when I'm developing my mobile business logic, but we'll save that for a later video. I'll go ahead and click Save. There we go. So because I'm running Platform Update 4, I have the option of publishing or unpublishing my workspace. And by default, when you create the mobile workspace, it is unpublished. So it says not published here. I'll go ahead and click Publish. There we go. My workspace is published. And now I can come back to my mobile device. And whenever a new workspace is published, the way that you refresh the list of workspaces from the mobile device is by pulling to refresh on that mobile dashboard. There we go. So my new workspace now appears at the bottom. I can go ahead and tap that workspace. And by tapping the workspace, I'm navigated to the workspace's landing page. Now in this case, the landing page by default would show the list of pages that exist inside of this mobile workspace, but I haven't created any pages yet for the sales order management workspace. So let's go ahead and go back to our mobile dashboard and let's edit that mobile workspace to add a page. So I've selected the mobile workspace. Next, I click Edit and I click Add Page. Now what I want this page to display a list of all sales orders. So I'll go ahead and type in all sales orders into the page title. I'll leave the page description blank for now. I'll click on Done. All right, now I'm taken to the page design experience. Now with the page design experience is one very important button that appears on this design experience, and it's the select fields. This is the button that allows you to determine what data fields and what information do you want to display to the user of the mobile workspace to display to that user when they open this page. And you get to select that data by opening an existing form in your operations web client. So I'll go ahead and show you how that works, and I'll explain a bit about what happens under the scenes. So the first step is to open a form that has the data I want. In this case, the All Sales Orders form has the information I want. So I go ahead and open that. All right, and now the form has opened. It's initialized and it's open. Now it's important that whenever I'm designing a page and later on when I'm designing an action for the page, that I always make sure I use a form that is a top level form. That means that the form has to be accessible directly from the menu. Somewhere inside of the menu, it should be available. Or also, if I can search for the form, then it's usable as well. But it needs to be a top-level form that I can either search for or access from the menu. All right, if I have a form that isn't immediately available from the menu or immediately available from searching, then we have a way of working around that, but it goes against our best practices and our design guidelines for the mobile app. I can show you how we work around that in our next video. So in this first video, I'm simply going to create a list of sales orders. I've just opened the All Sales Orders form and I haven't interacted with it at all. That's important. I haven't navigated anywhere. I haven't clicked on any buttons. I've opened it and it has initialized in its default state. The next step is to click Select Fields. All right, by clicking Select Fields, I'm taken into the page design experience where now I can select the data that I want to display inside of the mobile app. And we see that something's changed. I now have an orange border around the form. And the elements on the form that I can select to display inside of the mobile workspace, that I can select to display inside of my All Sales Orders page, have a plus button beside them, each one of the fields that I can add. So in this case, I'm simply going to select the sales order ID, the customer account, the customer name, and the sales taker. So as I selected each one of those fields, we notice on the right-hand side, the list of selected fields is updated. So now I see my sales order ID, customer account, the name, and the sales taker all appear in this design. And I can see that these are coming from a grid. So the system, the mobile framework, understands that these fields are coming from a grid. So when we render this page inside of the mobile app, we'll also render it as a grid or as a list. So these are all the fields that I care to select for this particular all sales orders page. I'll go ahead and click on done. This will stop the page design experience. There we go. So the orange border has disappeared. And I can reselect fields now if I wish, but I do not wish to reselect. I'll click back. This will take me back to the mobile workspace, where now I see in the list of pages, we have all sales orders. That's exactly what I expect. I don't need to make any changes to the workspace information. So I'll click done. I'll save. I'll get a warning. This is going to overwrite my existing one. Do I want to? Yes, I do. There we go. So it's been updated and it's already published. That's great. So now as a user, whenever my administrator updates the metadata for one of my mobile workspaces, I need to be informed that I need to refresh that metadata. It doesn't happen automatically because the mobile app isn't a highly connected client app. The user has to pull to refresh. So in this case, the sales order management workspace was the one that was updated. So if I pull to refresh on this workspace, I'll get that new information down. There we go. So now my all sales orders page is there. I can then navigate to my all sales orders. All right. And the data appears inside of my mobile device. And it's the same list of sales orders that I see here inside of the web client, where sales order 792 is the latest. And I see the four fields that I selected, the sales order ID, the customer account, customer name, and sales taker. Now, the way that this information is made available to the mobile app, I'll give you a short explanation for how that happens. So as a part of designing the page, I opened a top level form, and then I selected the four fields that I want to appear. So the mobile framework understands that those things occurred. It understands that the top level form, all sales orders, needs to be open, and then it understands how to copy the values from each of those four fields. And it also understands that those values are coming from within a grid, so it needs to iterate over all of the records in the data source, at least up to the cache size. And once it does that, it then sends those values down to the mobile app. So every time that the user, the first time the user opens the all sales orders page, they'll see the data will reach out to the server. The data will be loading. They'll have a blue loading bar at the top as we saw previously. And as a part of that loading process, what we're doing on the back end is we're opening that all sales orders form. We're opening it with that particular user context. In this case, we're opening the form as the administrator. And we're waiting for the form initialization logic to complete. We're waiting for things like execute query to complete. And once the form is done, it's initialized, then we go in through the process of copying those field values out from each record in the data source. And that goes up to a particular cache size. We'll talk about that cache size in a later video. So once the form is initialized, we copy the data values, we iterate over the records, we then serialize that information, and we send it down to the mobile device to display it to the user. Now, once it's displayed to the user, the information is also cached. That data is cached on the mobile device. The information we cache is not just a list of records and the fact that we need to display the sales order on top of the customer account, right above the customer name on top of the sales taker, but also we understand a bit about the underlying data bindings and the entities, or the tables that drive this data. We understand that this information is actually coming from the sales table. And we understand that there are fields on the sales table. We understand some of those fields are to related fields, such as the customer account or the sales taker. So we're getting that metadata, that schema information is also available inside of the mobile app when the data is downloaded and rendered. And that schema information is really important for a lot of the offline scenarios we enable, because to handle some of these scenarios in an offline manner, we have to understand when a record is created, when a record is deleted, and what that means for its entity and its related entities. We'll dive into that a bit more in a later video. So that's all we have for this initial video. In the next video, we'll step into how do we create a navigation from this list of sales orders into the sales order details.